Welcome to episode 249 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent on a mission to show you who the FBI is and what the FBI does through my award-winning books, blog, and podcast case reviews with former colleagues. Today, we get to speak to Masayo Halpin, who served in the FBI for 20 years. During her career, she was assigned to the Portland Division, where, for most of her career, she was on a violent crime squad working human sex trafficking cases. In this episode, Masayo reviews the case of a 14-year-old girl who was trafficked by Tony Armstrong, also known as Priceless, who, through manipulation and daily beatings, forced her into sex work. Although initially reluctant to cooperate with law enforcement, Lucy, not her real name, stayed in contact with Masayo and, after 5 years, was finally ready to testify against Armstrong. Masayo served as the Crimes Against Children coordinator in Portland and created the Portland Innocence Lost Task Force, now known as the Child Exploitation Task Force, comprised of four local law enforcement agencies and the FBI. They investigate cases involving the commercial sexual exploitation of children. Since retiring from the Bureau, Masayo is beginning a new career as a community college instructor, teaching courses on ethics and human trafficking. She's also working with an author on her memoir about her big undercover case and childhood events that no doubt played a role in her FBI career choices. As I mentioned during the interview, January is Human Trafficking Awareness Month, so I'm really pleased to bring this timely interview to you. Masayo and I discuss sexual exploitation, physical abuse, and rape, so I'm putting a trigger warning label on this episode. But I hope you listen, because I so admire and appreciate Masayo sharing personal, intimate parts of her FBI story with us. Now, before we get to the interview, I have to say, Happy New Year! Woohoo! I also had to let you know that this month, FBI Retired Case File Review is 6 years old. I have loved every minute of every episode I've produced. As an independent podcast host and producer, I spent a lot of time putting this show together, but I also have some very exciting publishing and TV opportunities coming up in 2022. Now, don't worry, I have no plans to stop podcasting, but I need some help. Over the past 6 years, you've been supporting the show by buying my books. Now, you can support the show by buying me a coffee. A cup of coffee to show me just how much you're enjoying the show. I'm going to use your generous contributions to pay someone to help me edit and produce each episode. Actually, I've already found someone, a listener. So, hey, Dan, glad to have you on board. Now, in your podcast app's description of this episode, there are links to where you can donate to my Buy Me a Coffee campaign. Visit my website to learn about my nonfiction and crime fiction books, and join my reader team to receive my monthly email to keep you up to date with entertainment news about the FBI and books, TV, and movies. In my January email, I review the movie Patriot's Day, just in time for my second episode on the Boston Marathon bombing. Thank you for your support. Now here's the show. I want to welcome my guest, Masayo Halpin. Hey, Masayo, how are you?
Hi, Jerry. Good. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, this is fantastic. Everyone in the audience knows that I have been requesting that anyone listening who knows an agent, a retired agent, who has a human trafficking case to let me know, because January, of course, is Human Trafficking Month. It was really funny because when we connected on LinkedIn, I assume someone told you that I was looking for you, but it was really
so funny.
Yeah, it just was a coincidence that we connected. And when I looked at your when I looked at your LinkedIn profile, it was right there that you had been working these type of cases for most of your career and even in retirement.
Yeah, it was just karma. It was just the stars were lined up or something, because I did not know you were looking for someone, and I just perfect timing.
Yeah, so I'm real excited that you're here. We're talking about a very serious subject. I think probably the first thing that we should do is define human trafficking and go through the different types and the type that you're going to be talking about today.
Okay. So human trafficking is, I think, an umbrella term. It's a broad term. It means basically someone uses force, fraud, or coercion to force someone to do something that they don't want to do. So we have different types of human trafficking. The one that people know most about is the commercial sex trafficking, also known as prostitution. There's also labor trafficking, agricultural trafficking, domestic servitude. Those are probably the big ones in the United States, but you know, you go outside the United States, you also have child soldiers, organ trafficking. So what I'm going to talk about is very specific. It's what we call the commercial sexual exploitation of children. It is also known as domestic sex trafficking. It's not adult trafficking. They're not sex workers. Right now, Oregon is trying to pass some law to make prostitution legal because sex workers want that. That's not what this is about. This is about the child sex trafficking. So these kiddos don't consent to it. They can't consent to having sex with an adult. And it looks very different from adult trafficking or adult sex work. So these kiddos, typically between the ages of 12 and 18, I know the FBI has recovered a couple of kiddos as young as 9 during Operation Cross Country. Typically when they're that young, they are introduced into the game by a family member. So what we call this is the game or the life. And that's what there's a complete culture that exists, and they have their own language. They have their own rules. They have their own music, everything. So it's called the game. And so you're going to hear me talk about probably some terminology that I'll try to define it as I go along. This case is about a little girl. Her name is Lucy. I changed it to protect her identity. And her trafficker, Anthony Armstrong, also known as Priceless, that was his street name. So Lucy was adopted at 2 years old. She struggled getting along with her adoptive mom. She had a tough time. So at one point, she finally left to go live with her biological father. While she was living with her father, she was molested by her uncle. While working these cases, just like I used to be a hostage negotiator, you find the hook or the trigger. This was Lucy's hook. It's very common for these kiddos to have been molested or sexually abused when they were younger.
Now, you're telling us about Lucy and her background growing up, but are they the only girls that could fall prey to this type of abuse?
No. Any kiddo can fall prey to this kind of abuse. If you talk to a trafficker, they will tell you, I can turn any girl into what they call a hoe or a bitch. It's all about the game, how good that they can manipulate someone. And kids are easier to manipulate because they don't have the development. And I've had a kiddo from a very stable home with good parents who got caught up in the game. Boys are getting trafficked. So it could happen to anyone. Unfortunately, there is a profile, for the lack of a better word. Typically, it is the kiddo who doesn't have the adult male figure at home or who is running away from home, who's struggling with mom. I had a kiddo who her hook was her mom. Her dad died when she was young and her mom had a boyfriend who molested her. And when she told the police, mom said, no, don't tell the police because he pays the bills. And so she had to take her statement back. And that was her hook, her relationship with her mom. So it's all different. It's different for every kiddo. It's different for every trafficker. There's no two cases that are the same, but there is a pattern, though. If you have a kid who is running away or who is skipping school, who may have a cell phone or nice clothes or getting their hair done, and it's not coming from the parent, those are clues that they need to look for. That kiddo might be in trouble. He or she might be involved in something that is not real good. But yeah, generally it is maybe a little girl who's been sexually abused. That's very common. But again, it could happen to anyone. So Lucy was molested by her uncle, and at age 14, she began running away. Now, Armstrong had a similar yet different life. Unfortunately, when I'm working these cases, I have a lot of interaction with the victim. I spend a lot of time with the victim. I don't spend much time with the trafficker. So I don't get to talk to them and ask them how they got into the game or what started it for them. But from what I know, Armstrong began running away at age 12. He was a chronic runaway and he had many arrests for distribution of drugs. So he was what they call a D-boy, a drug dealer. So I first met Lucy at the Juvenile Detention Center in Portland, Oregon. She was 15 years old and she was there for robbery and prostitution. The probation officer there who had some training on commercial sex trafficking of children called me and said, "Hey, we have this kiddo. Can you come talk to her?" So I said, okay. So I went in, I took my victim specialist with me. Lucy was, I have to say, was the first kiddo I had ever met with. I had just started working these cases. I had one other case and then Lucy was my first minor that I talked to.
Do you think that's why it's, you know, special for you? Because it sounds like when we talked before earlier, you know, it sounds like she really got to you, really affected you. Do you think it was because it was first, or was there just something about Lucy that made you connect with her case?
You know, when you just asked her that, a chill just went down my spine. Lucy, yeah, probably affected me in a lot of ways on a personal level and a professional level. And she was one of the few, well, I'm jumping ahead, but one of the few success stories too. But yeah, when I first met her, she rocked my world. I had never had any experience working these cases and I had experience working with kids. You know, I did a lot of volunteer work. So I was around kids her age a lot, but I walked into that room. She was all smiles. She was just the cutest little girl. And I looked at her, I'm like, am I in the wrong room? I mean, because I had no idea what to expect. And so I walked
in. What were you told initially?
Funniest thing. So Lucy is not her real name. So I'm half Japanese and half Black. And the probation officer who called me has a Japanese last name. I had never met her before. And Lucy's real name is a Japanese name. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, this is just so coincidental. So I walked in meeting the probation officer thinking she was going to be Japanese. She was actually a white lady. And she explained, she goes, I have a Japanese last name, but my husband's Hawaiian. And so I'm not Japanese. I said, that is so funny. I said, I was expecting a Japanese one. And she said, that's so funny because when I met Lucy, I was expecting a little Japanese girl because she has a Japanese first name. So I was expecting kind of a rough, you know, street girl who, you know, was going to basically spit at me and cuss at me and tell me to go pound sand. And, you know, but I walked in there. She was just the sweetest little girl. And she was all full of smiles. And I fell in love with her, right? We were just like you said, what about her? I fell in love with her. I mean, she just broke my heart. And she had no problem talking about the game. She said, I'll talk to you about the game. I have no problem with that. But I'm not going to talk to you about my daddy, my trafficker. So daddy is what most pimps have their girls call them, even though it's a boyfriend and girlfriend relationship in the girl's mind. So this man is, in her mind, a boyfriend. He wants her to call him daddy. So she said, I'm not going to talk against my daddy because you want to put him in jail. I looked at her. And one thing I learned about working these cases is you never lie to them. They are street smart. They are profilers. They know how to survive and they can read you because their life depends on it. They have to read their customers. And so I knew not to lie to her. I looked at her. I said, yes, you're right. I do want to put him in jail and I will probably do it with or without you. Chances are she's not the only girl he's trafficking. So she said, okay. She said, you know, I'm not going to talk about him because you snitch, you die. And that phrase stayed with me my entire career after that. You snitch, you die. She said, I'm not going to talk about him. I said, okay. I said, well, let's talk about you. So she gladly opened up about herself, talked about the game. And I remember she said, well, one night in Phoenix, I was working and I was raped twice in one night. And I just looked at her and I was like, I didn't know what to say. And I continued to smile because she was just such a happy little girl. I said, well, how did that make you feel? She said, that's just part of the game. And I was like, wow, okay. Wow. And I knew right then I needed to get my mind straight in order to work these cases because just talking about it is very emotional for me right now. So when I was working these cases, I told people I had to put my shields up, you know, like a Star Trek. I had shields up, you know, because I could not show emotion. I could not be crying. I had to be strong because these girls looked at me as the FBI agent and knew I was strong. So I had to be. So I was like Wonder Woman with my bracelets, you know, bing, 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 bing. I just couldn't let it affect me as hard as it was.
I take it also that that's necessary because they've put up this shield and that's the way they've been able to deal with everything. And I guess you feel some responsibility of not taking it upon yourself to break down that shield until you know there's a safe place for them to land on the other side.
Exactly. Yeah. That's part of, working these cases for me was the first thing we did was to find a safe place for them before I even started talking to them. I had to make sure that they were safe because that's the most important thing. Even if it's just for a minute, even if it's just for an hour or a day, because more likely than not, they will go back to their trafficker until they're ready to get out. So when I talk about trafficking, I always tell people, you know, we have adult friends, you know, girlfriends, you know, guy friends, whatever, who are in relationships. And you tell them, you know, that guy's not good for you. You need to get out. Well, she's not going to leave him until she's ready. And she's an adult with developed, you know, brain. These are kiddos who don't have the brain development and we can't expect them to act like adults. So we can't go in saying, you need to be out of this relationship. You need to get out of this. This is bad for you. They are not listening. They can't understand that. We have to meet them where they are. That was one of the things. I had to meet Lucy where she was, and she was not ready to leave the game. And she made that very clear, and nothing I could have said or done would have changed her. It changed her mind, got her out of the game at that point.
I think many people will be asking, why is this an FBI case? Why, you know, where is the jurisdiction? How does the FBI get involved in something like this?
Good question. So on the West Coast, we have a West Coast circuit. And, you know, naturally, when you think of FBI, you think of crossing state lines or the interstate aspect of it. So on a very basic level, we have a West Coast circuit. These traffickers traffic their girls from city to city along the West Coast, starting in Seattle, down to Olympia, down to Portland, all the way down to Sacramento, San Francisco, all the way down the West Coast. Then they hit Phoenix. They might hit Anchorage and Honolulu, and they just continue to work the circuit. So right there, that gives us jurisdiction. One police agency can't do it because their jurisdiction is typically within their city. Whereas the FBI, our jurisdiction, as you know, is everywhere in the country. So we're the best equipped to work these cases. It's very common. So when I was working, I knew who the task force agent was in Sacramento, San Francisco, LA, San Diego, Seattle. We knew each other. We were on the phone with each other all the time. Hey, I got a kiddo. I think she's coming up there. So we were all on the same page. That alone, I feel like only the FBI can work it a good case like that because we have the ability. We have the resources. Our statutes, we have federal statutes, 1591, sex trafficking of children by force or fraud, coercion, and then 2421, transportation. And so we have the federal statutes. We have the resources. We start task forces. And so I started my task force in Portland and I was able to get Portland police, Beaverton police, Tigard police, Vancouver police, and we work these cases together. Every task force has that. So you have, you know, all of law enforcement working these cases together and the FBI is just basically the central point of us coming together. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, absolutely.
So Lucy contacted me when she was about 19 years old. I contacted her at juvenile detention when she was 15. She told me, basically, I'll talk to you, but I'm not going to talk against my trafficker. So from that point on, I made contact with her a few times, kept tabs on her. So I knew when she was in custody. I knew when she wasn't. She continued to work for her trafficker, Armstrong, who she called Tony. And then again, when she turned 19, she reached back out to me through her advocate. Since that time, when I first saw her, she had been arrested for prostitution and she'd also been arrested by the police for compelling prostitution. Now, compelling prostitution is basically the local charge for trafficking. She had also had a child by her trafficker. So she was a mom. She said, hey, I want to talk. So I said, okay. I had a lot of questions for her that I knew would come up during the investigation. So I said, why don't we meet for coffee? And so I met her for coffee near her home. And first question I asked her, I said, why do you want to talk? I need to know what's going on with you. I need to know what's going on in your mind. Just for my purposes, I wanted to know why. And she was very honest. She said, because Tony wants custody of our son and I don't want him to have custody. I want my son to be away from him. I don't want Tony to have any influence on my son until he's about 16 or until he's older. She didn't want him to see the trafficking. I said, okay.
Was she still with Tony?
So she wasn't with Tony, but she had worked for him fairly recently before meeting with me. And the strangest thing, so Tony filed for custody. The baby was removed from Lucy's custody because of she was a prostitute. And even though Tony was her trafficker, DHS gave custody, temporary custody to Tony's mom. So whenever Lucy wanted to go see the baby, she had to go to Tony's mom's house. And who, of course, would always be there waiting for her? Tony. Even though in the order, he was not supposed to have any contact with her. She said he would always be there. He would always harass me, try to get me to work for him again. So she was like, I'm done. I need him gone. And so the second question I had to ask her was about the compelling prostitution, because they're going to ask, is she a trafficker herself? So she explained that when she was out on the streets working with her then boyfriend, who was not a trafficker, he was actually a gang member and he did not want to traffic her. She said she ran into a little kiddo on the street and saw that she was what you call a renegade. So a renegade would be a kiddo without a trafficker, without a pimp. And so she was not working with a pimp. And Lucy knew how dangerous that was. And so she said, so I took her in and I wanted to teach her the rules, to teach her to protect herself. I said, okay. Portland police eventually dropped that case because they didn't have enough on her. But still, it's on her record and I knew it was going to come up. So, and then, the last thing I wanted to explain to her was, you know, we want to believe that law enforcement, we come in with our capes on and we're going to come and save the day and save you. But in reality, if Tony's boys want to come and jack with you, we're not going to make it there on time. You know, they know where you are. They know where you live. They know you go visit your baby at Tony's mom's house. If they want to mess with you, they will get there before the police, even if you call 911. And I said, as much as we'd like to believe we will protect you, honestly, we can't, not in a timely fashion. And she says, I get that. She's like, I'm okay with that. And she was a strong cookie. She said, I'm okay with that. I got this. I said, Okay. I said, all right, let's go. And so we met about a week later and she explained that she met Tony when she was 14 at a friend's house. She thought he was a D-boy, just a drug dealer. And so she kind of liked him. And then she had some probation violations and things. So she was gone for 4 weeks in custody. And then she ran into him again 4 weeks later. And right before she ran into him, she was at her mom's, her adoptive mom's house, and her mom had given her some money. So when she saw Tony again, he said, hey, do you have some money for me? So in the game, he is basically asking her to choose him to be her pimp, to be her trafficker. It's called choosing up, or he may say, you know, break yourself, which means that you need to give me your money and now you work for me. Well, Lucy didn't know any of that because she hadn't been in the game. And so she gave him her money and she just looked at him like, why? I don't understand why I'm giving you my money. Well, the next day, Tony had Lucy go out with another girl, Brittany. Brittany was maybe 18 at the time. And they went to a house at 49th and Killingsworth in Portland. And she turned her first trick for Armstrong. And she remembered the exact day. She remembered it was Valentine's Day, 2007. She got back to Tony and she handed him her money and she threw the money down on the table and said, happy Valentine's Day. And he said, I don't believe in Valentine's. And from that point on, she was working for him. And so he took her to Phoenix right away. They jumped on the Greyhound, went to Phoenix. First night in Phoenix, Lucy was walking the track because Tony had a friend who was a trafficker or pimp in Phoenix. And he told Tony where the track was, where what corner to stand on, where to make the most money. So Lucy was on the track. And that first night, she had five pimps try to recruit her. So she was scared. She called Tony and said, what do I do? He said, just hide in the bathroom until I can get there. And the next day, he and Lucy went back to Portland. It was just a little too dangerous for her. And she was still fairly new to the game, too.
It sounds like it happened so quick. I mean, of course, and you know, in TV shows and in the movies, you know, the boyfriend seduces her. He grooms her before he sends her out, saying, you know, if you really love me, you'll do this for us.
Right.
But she did it the very next day after her second meeting with him.
Right. Yeah. You are exactly right. There usually is a phase where he has to groom her and get her mentally prepared for it. But, you know, it all depends on the pimp. I've had cases where I had one case where a kiddo was in middle school and he was coming to her track meets. He didn't start trafficking her until she was in high school. I had another case where the girl met him in a chat room online. She was down in Eugene. She said, I came up to visit him. She said, within an hour, I was working the track. I didn't even know what happened. So it all kind of depends on the trafficker, how good he thinks his game is, how vulnerable the victim is. I think Tony knew that Lucy didn't have anywhere to go. She didn't have a stable home, and she was basically living couch to couch. And so it was kind of easy for him. And, you know, the one thing I'm not getting into much either is about the manipulation that goes on, how he manipulates her and how he gets her to fall in love with him. I mean, these kiddos are craving attention from an adult, and he listened to her, something that she probably didn't have in her life. One, she didn't have a stable male role model, and one that definitely didn't listen to her. He listened to her, and she shared his, you know, her life with him that first night. And so there was a connection there. Again, these are kids who don't have the brain development to understand, and she's in love with him. So, you know, Lucy was in love with Tony. When you're in love, you will do anything, especially when you're a little kid and you don't have anything else waiting for you or to go home to.
Was there any violence? Did he use physical force at any time?
Oh, yeah. So I am actually getting to that. So when she recruited another girl off the track for Tony, that's usually a good thing when you recruit someone for your trafficker, because it adds to your stable or your family. And so you try to recruit other girls. Well, she had recruited this girl, and she, I don't want to say made the mistake, but she, while he was talking to the other girl and trying to turn, you know, put his game on her, Lucy called him a bitch. Well, that didn't go well. Tony grabbed her by the hair, dragged her to the bathroom, and just started beating her. And that was the first time he ever beat her, ever laid his hands on her. But unfortunately, that did not end. It got to the point where Armstrong was beating her for no reason, because she put the glass on the table, because he was tired, because he wanted to. Just, he became a very violent, what we call a gorilla pimp. So they went back to Phoenix, and Armstrong met one of his brothers, Theo, who was also a trafficker. Theo had a girl, Brittany. Brittany was the same girl that took Lucy to the house her first night, and they were working together in Phoenix. So they stayed in a hotel together. So they shared a room. Brittany did not like Theo. She did not want to be with Theo. Theo was very violent and beat her all the time. And she just wanted away from him. She was scared of him. Lucy said that Armstrong got very comfortable laying his hands on her. And she said that she said he became very comfortable laying his hands on me. And so these two girls are with these two guys, and they're just getting beat every day. So while they were in Phoenix, Theo and Armstrong came into the bedroom where the two girls were sitting on the bed, and Armstrong looked at them, and the girls knew something was wrong because they could, you mean, again, they read the body language. Armstrong said, "How old are you, Lucy?" And Lucy lied and said, "I'm 16. And Theo looked at Brittany and said, "Brittany, how old is she?" Brittany knew not to lie because she knew that she was going to get a beating if she did. So she said, "She's 14. So they told Armstrong and Theo that Lucy was 14. And that's going to be important later when we ended up charging him. So while in Phoenix, Lucy was picked up by a trick. So this was the one night she was raped, and she went back to the hotel, and Armstrong said, "I don't care. Take a shower and get back out there." So she went back out there. She ran into three guys who had $175 on them. And she called Armstrong and said, "Hey, I can have this date with these three guys for $175. After I do that, can I come in?" He He said, yeah, you get this last $175 and you can come in. So she went on this date with these three guys. She had sex with the first one, who was a smaller guy. Well, he got a little crazy and started hitting her. Lucy started hitting him back. So the two other guys, who were much bigger, Lucy said one was probably a boxer because he was so big, came in and just started beating her. They started raping her. They pulled a knife on her. They raped her from front and back for 3.5 hours. She told them she was 14. She told them she was pregnant. She tried everything, and they just wouldn't stop. So another chick Lucy had while she was in Phoenix threw her out of the car. So she's now starting to get scared. Her money that she was making, she went from $800 to $900 a night to $400 to $500 a night because she was afraid to get in the car. She was afraid of her customers. She was stopped by the police outside their hotel room, and she texted Brittany and said, hey, don't come out here. The cops are here. Well, Brittany said, I'm out. She came downstairs. She looked at the police officer, said, I want to talk. So the police took them both in. Brittany talked against Theo, and Brittany was 18. So she was sent to Los Angeles, to a facility in Los Angeles. Lucy was sent to a group home until her mom could pick her up. And Theo was arrested. They executed a search warrant on their hotel room, and Theo was arrested for trafficking. Well, Lucy didn't stick around for her mom to pick her up. She took off before her mom got there and got back together with Tony. So the thing also during this time, Lucy tried to leave. She ran away. She left Armstrong several times, but she would try different traffickers. You know, she tried a woman trafficker at one point. But she always came back to Armstrong because she loved him. They had this bond. They had this connection. And so in April of 2008, Lucy had a regular in Phoenix by the name of Tom Jones, a very common, plain name that, you know, when you hear it, it's like, okay, that can't be real. Well, Tom rented an apartment for Lucy, bought groceries for Lucy and Armstrong. So according to Lucy, Tom Jones knew of Armstrong, paid their rent, and even got Lucy a dog. But something was going on in the apartment next door. So Lucy and Armstrong decided to leave because they were afraid the cops were coming. So Lucy had worked for Armstrong over the years. They were in San Diego, Las Vegas, Los Angeles, Portland, Phoenix. They did the West Coast circuit. They were traveling a lot. In 2009, on June 28th, again, Lucy's mind was like a steel trap. She found out she was pregnant. She wanted to be done. Well, Armstrong's plan was, you work 3 more months and then you can stop. She said, no, I don't think so. She went back to Portland, turned herself in because she had a probation violation and stayed in Portland to have the baby. Her son was born in January 2010. She continued working for Armstrong. And then, because again, she can't really get away from him. During one fight they had, Armstrong was beating her and he either slipped or something happened where he accidentally hit the baby who was in between them. And Lucy said, that's it. I have got to get out of here. She grabbed a knife and said, I'm out of here. I'm leaving and I have to get out. So she left her son with Armstrong for that night. She came back the next day and recovered her son, but that was it. She was done with him after that one beating. And then in November 2011, she contacted me. And so we sat down and went over her case, and it's funny. So Lucy is a very happy, very, very happy little girl. And when she got to the point where she was talking about the two rapes, she started tearing up. And I knew right then, I said, okay, let's call this a day. Let's come back again tomorrow.
You saw that difference between the first time you talked to her when she was 15 and she could talk about it and still smile and laugh. And now when she...
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah.
And she was definitely ready. Yeah.
Yeah. So she was, a lot of times, unfortunately, these kids, so she had aged out of the system. So she was out of state custody. She was 19. She ended up, I'm jumping ahead, but she ended up having two kids. And when she needed money, because I talked to her later, she goes, if I need money, I'm going to post an ad, catch a date to make money so I can feed my kids. You know, so unfortunately, they get out of the game, but they always know it's there that they can always fall back on if they have to. But anyway, back to her case. So my job at that point, I had to corroborate her story. These cases are he said, she said. It was an old case that had happened a few years prior. So I knew I was going to have a challenge trying to find witnesses and evidence. But again, Lucy's mind was a steel trap. She had dates, she had locations, she had streets. I mean, it was amazing. So did the best I could. Fortunately, Theo's arrest in Phoenix, Phoenix police, I love them. When they did the search warrant on the hotel, they gathered all this evidence and some of it was against Armstrong as well. So they had taken explicit photos of Lucy and Brittany. I had Greyhound tags. I had Greyhound itineraries, registrations at hotels. I even had one note from Legacy Suites where they stayed that had a flag on it said, and the flag says, I put them on do not rent because security said there are prostituting. So even the hotel management knew, or hotel knew, that they were engaged in prostitution. When Lucy was working in different cities, oftentimes Tony was not there because he had to report to his probation officer in Portland a lot. And what we call that being on automatic when you work and your trafficker is not there with you. But she still had to send money to him because he wasn't working. He needed money to get anywhere he needed to go. And so Lucy would wire him money through Western Union, which is a great paper trail. So I was able to find that. Witnesses, Brittany. I was able to find Brittany and I asked her about Lucy. She goes, oh, I remember Lucy. She says, I remember the day Theo and Armstrong came into the hotel room and asked us how old Lucy was. She said, I remember Lucy getting beat every day. And she said, Armstrong beat Lucy like a man. And I hear that a lot. I heard that a lot in these cases because I think when we think of a man hitting a woman, we think of an open-handed slap. These guys are beating these women and girls with a fist. And the girls described it as, he beat me like a man. And so Brittany remembered that Lucy got beat more than she did. So Tom Jones, I said, Lucy, I know we're the FBI and I know we're good, but I need more than Tom Jones. She said, Tom Jones was his name. He's Asian male, late 30s. He was about 5'7". I said, that's going to be a tough one for me to find. I said, is there anything else you can give me? She said, oh, when he was in his 20s, I think he robbed a bank in New Mexico. And sure enough, I found Tom Jones. I sent an agent to interview him down in Phoenix. He said, oh, I remember Lucy. He said, I was in love with Lucy. I wanted to save Lucy. I wanted her to get out of prostitution. So he knew Lucy was a prostitute. He said, oh, and I knew Armstrong was a pimp. I knew that he was her pimp. I saw Lucy give Armstrong money. That's pretty good evidence right there.
Oh, absolutely.
So, yeah. So the federal statutes we used, 18 U.S.C. 1591, sex trafficking of children or by force, fraud, or coercion. And then 18 U.S.C. 2421, transportation. So when I was working these cases, I believe it's changed recently, but 1591, sex trafficking of children, we had to prove that the trafficker knew the victim was under 18. In this case, we did because Brittany, who said, oh, I remember when they came in. And then transportation, you didn't have to prove that the trafficker knew the victim was under 18. I believe that has changed, and I don't think that you have to prove that anymore for 1591, which is good. So we charge Armstrong with one count of sex trafficking a minor, one count of sex trafficking by force, fraud, or coercion, and one count of transportation. So for grand jury, before we indicted, Lucy testified in grand jury. The advocate said this would be good for her healing. I think she's ready for it, and she's a great witness. I said, okay. Because a lot of these cases, you are basically re-victimizing them by making them relive this and telling people all the, you know, the prosecutor, telling the investigator, telling the judge, telling the grand jury.
Right. So you don't want to and over again. Right.
Right. Right. So I said, okay. And I asked Lucy, I said, you ready for this? She goes, yeah, I want to do this. So she testified in grand jury. I was waiting outside. And when she came out, again, all smiles, grand jurors came out in tears. And, you know, it was pretty cool because we were standing there talking and they came and they looked at her and they said, you are so brave. Thank you for sharing your story and just, you know, making her feel good, which was nice. And so, which I don't think she could have got had she not testified in grand jury. Trial is a totally different animal. I said, I do not want her to get up on that stand and be cross-examined by an attorney. And having to sit there and look at Tony in the eye with all his boys in the back, I said, that's a different animal. So the prosecutor agreed and said, okay, we're going to offer him 10 years just so Lucy wouldn't have to testify. Well, Armstrong, like most traffickers, are very arrogant and think they can manipulate. So when I arrested Armstrong, he he did the three strikes, you're out with me. When he first saw me, he goes, oh, Agent Halpin, I would never do anything like that. Very respectful, you know, and just almost demure. Very, you know, oh, I would never do anything like that. And I'm looking at him because, you know, I don't have patience. I really don't have patience for these guys, unfortunately, because I know that they're trying to manipulate me because, one, I'm a woman, and two, that's what they do. And so I looked at him, I said, okay. I said, you know what? I said, you don't have to talk to me. I didn't even try to interview him. I said, I don't want you to talk to me. Okay. So, and then he goes, well, Agent Halpin, she was doing her own thing. I was just trying to help her. And I said, okay, Mr. Armstrong. I said, please stop talking to me. And then, of course, strike three, he goes, okay, well, I used to do that, but I don't do that anymore. And I said, okay, three strikes, you're out. I said, you need to stop talking to me because I don't need you to talk to me. I said, I have a case against you that is so solid, I don't even need to talk to you. That's how solid my case is, okay? And so he couldn't manipulate me. So he said, okay. I started listening to his jail calls, which I always do with my subjects. They are told that the calls are being recorded, so they know that we could be listening. So he's talking to his friends. He's talking to his family. Everyone is talking him into taking the deal. He's like, nope, don't want to take the deal. And so he starts threatening Lucy. He starts trying to convince her to leave town during the trial, offered her money, and he just wouldn't take it. He said, nope, I want to see the evidence. So my prosecutor at this point is not real happy. He said, he told the defense, he said, if you're going to make us do all this work to put this discovery together to show you the evidence, we're taking the deal off the table. So Armstrong stood strong. He said, nope, I want to see the evidence. I think I can beat this. So we took the deal off the table. I listened to a jail call after he looked at all our evidence. And I quote, he was talking to a friend, bro, they got me. Gun in hand, blood on shirt, they got me. And so, wow. Yeah, he pled guilty to one count of sex trafficking. So during the sentencing, Lucy had the opportunity to make a statement, and she wanted to. So we were all there to support her. She walked up and looked at Tony and she said, Tony, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that this has happened. I'm so sorry that we're here today. And I'm sorry that you're going to prison. And at this point, my shield was getting really weak. And I was like, oh. And so the judge looked at Mr. Armstrong and looked at Lucy and said, he said, the fact that she is apologizing to you for all of the brutality, the torture, the humiliation, everything you have done to her shows me how messed up she is because of you. And he sentenced him to 16 years in prison.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm sure everyone is wondering about the child. And if during this time when you were preparing for trial, possible trial, or for the plea, she was able to see her son.
She did continue to see her son. She got custody of her son. She got an apartment. And in the meantime, she had another baby. So she had two babies now. She was working a full-time job. She was doing great. Armstrong was in prison. So there's a couple of things here that hit me personally. So while working with Lucy at the end there, she said, I have to take my son to see his dad in prison. I said, Lucy, don't do that. And she says, well, he needs to see his dad. I said, no, actually, he doesn't. He should remember his dad the way he is now. He can write letters, send photos. I said, do not take him to prison. So when I grew up, my dad was in prison and my mom took us to go see my dad. I still see him in prison in the little outfit. I think it was an orange jumpsuit. And I said, you don't want to do that to your kiddo. And I shared that with her. I said, trust me, I've been there. That picture will stay with him forever. I said, don't do it. She did anyway, which, you know, it was her decision. But the other thing that really hit home with me, which is why Lucy was, you know, you asked in the beginning why this case was tough for me. So when I went, Lucy was out of the game and she was doing great. My media rep wanted to do a story for Human Trafficking Month and she asked for a success story. I said, well, Lucy's a great story. And at this point, I'm out of trafficking. I'm working recruitment and community outreach. So my shields are completely down. And so she said, okay, well, will you set it up? So I reached out to Lucy and I said, hey, would you be willing to talk? She's like, sure. So we go out there to meet with Lucy and her son is running around and he's probably about maybe four or five or six. And he's running around the apartment and she's telling her story and hearing her story again without my shields up, just, it was like an arrow through my heart and I couldn't I could not make eye contact with anyone in that room. And my media rep looked at me later. She goes, you had a tough time in there, didn't you? I said, yeah. I said, I haven't worked these cases. And I said, my shields are down and I wasn't expecting that. I saw this little boy running around the home, and I grew up without a father because, I grew up without a father because he was in prison. And I just did that to this little kid. I said,
please don't apologize. I think sharing that is what helps people understand who we really are and what we're bringing with us when we do these cases. So,
yeah, I agree. Yeah. People think we're human.
Right.
So, yeah, it was tough for me because I know what it's like to grow up without a father. Lissy is Mexican, but her son was black, half black. And so I know what his journey is going to be like. It's not an easy road. Me, myself being half black and half Japanese and always being different and always, you know, and I knew having a dad in prison, that's just not something you want. I mean, I was so ashamed for it for so long. And now this kiddo is going to have to go through that. And I felt responsible. And I felt like I just did to this kid what happened to me. And my media rep, when we got back to the office, I said that to her and I got emotional. She goes, no, you didn't. She said, he did it to himself. Lucy put him in jail, not you. And I said, you're right.
And she did it for her son, not to him.
Right. And when we arrested Armstrong, he was out of the game and he was living in a trailer with a different family now, another woman and a kid. And he told me, he goes, I'm out of the game now. I don't do that anymore. You know, I believed him because looking at him, looking where we got him, he's not in the game anymore. And I looked at him. I said, you know what? I said, I believe you, but you still have to answer for what you did. And Lucy made him answer for it. I just helped her. Lucy, at the very end there, she was working a full-time job. When I last spoke to her advocate, she didn't tell me much. She just looked at me and said, Lucy's having a tough time. So I don't know what that means. And unfortunately, with these cases, because when they turn 18, they age out of the system and I lose track of them. And they definitely don't want to keep track of me, you know, because even if they do get out and they're successful and in treatment, they don't want to keep in touch with me because I remind them of a bad time in their life, which is understandable. So I lose track of them. I don't know what happens to them, which is, you know, I wish I did know, but I don't know what Lucy's, I don't know how she's doing.
You talk about how your background affected this particular case. But of course, you know, as FBI agents, we're putting people in jail. I mean, that's the goal, for someone to see the consequences of their crimes. After this case, did you think about that again?
Yeah. Yes. So I didn't realize that until working these cases. All the puzzle pieces started coming together for me and I started seeing things and having memories come back. I'm like, oh, these little girls would share with me and say, oh, well, it's very common for a pimp to have a square family, but he would come home and bring them money. Well, that's what my dad did. And I'm like, wait a second. And my dad drove the blue light blue Cadillac and had the pimp hat and had the pimp stick and had all this stuff. And I'm like, wait a second. It all kind of came together. So yeah, I thought about it. I thought about it every day working these cases. I realized that I was connected to the cases more than I thought because of my father, and things started coming up and I started figuring things out.
I could sit here and ask you lots more questions about your father and, you know, what you mean by what you just said and why he was in prison. But I understand that you're putting it all together in a book.
Yes. And that's what my book is about. So I spent the last almost 4 years now working with a writer, Jim Patton. He has written a couple other books. He is the actual author, but I am the subject of the book. So I share my life, my experiences, a lot of information on trafficking and working these cases, and a big case that I worked, which was an undercover operation. And it was really hard for me, I have to admit, because I'm a very private person. And my husband even said to me, he goes, why are you doing this? Why are you writing this book and sharing all this stuff about you? And I looked at him, I said, that's easy. I said, because if it can help one kid, you know, feel better or help them get out of a hole or help them have some self-esteem or understand that they can do anything in their lives. If I can help one kiddo, then it's worth it. I feel like I had a challenging childhood, which was very different from my coworkers in the FBI, but I became an FBI agent. And I mean, before that, I was a lawyer. So if I can do it, I mean, I'm not the smartest kid on the block, but, you know, I worked really hard and I want to show kids that they can do anything. The only, you know, and I hate that cliche, the only thing that's stopping you is yourself, but it's so true. And because of a couple of people in my life who encouraged me, I pushed ahead and didn't let anything stop me.
I have to have you promise me right here with everybody listening that when the book does come out, I know you're looking for a publisher and all of that now, that you'll come back and talk about some of the other cases that are in the book and also details, you know, about your childhood and your father. Can we pencil that in?
Absolutely. Yes. It's hard to be a kid these days, especially a kid of color. It's just a tough world out there right now. There's a kid out there listening who this might, you know, touch. I'm more than happy to share.
Well, thank you. Just what you've shared with us today has been remarkable. I really appreciate how open and transparent you've been today.
Well, thank you. I went into the FBI never thinking I would get in because of my background. And I learned so much from the FBI. It molded me as a person, as an adult.
Well, you started getting into my standard question of when and why you joined the FBI.
So I joined the FBI January 1997, my EOD. I joined because I was a sociology major in a very liberal arts school on the West Coast, and I wanted to change the system. I wanted to fight the man. And
was there a particular person that you met, an agent, or did a recruiter come to campus?
So I went to Howard Law School. I always figured I'd end up in politics somehow, but I'm kind of glad I didn't. No recruiter, nothing. I was working in Philadelphia and a girlfriend of mine from Howard called and we were talking and she said, I'm going to apply to the FBI. And I laughed and I said, are you crazy? I said, you just don't apply to the FBI. People just don't join the FBI. So I Googled it and I said, well, I probably can't carry a gun, but I could be a lawyer for the FBI because I've always had an interest in criminal law. I wanted to be a prosecutor or a public defender or something like that. I first called the local office and I said, hey, how do I become an attorney? And they said, well, all our attorneys are agent attorneys. So you'd have to be an agent to be an attorney. I said, okay. So, you know, I filled out the application, which is very long. I said, you know, why am I doing this? I'm never going to get in. My dad's an ex-con. My mom's foreign-born. My brother's foreign-born. I got all these issues. I said, I'm never going to get in. 6 months later, believe it or not, I'm going to the academy, which is pretty fast. And I had a couple of issues, like I said, with my family, but I got in. And, you know, it's funny, over the 20 years, I always expected someone to tap me on the shoulder and say, hey, we made a mistake. It's time for you to go, you know, and I'm glad they didn't. Yeah. I love our core values. I loved the agency. I loved working for the agency. And whenever I would meet people, like I play tennis and they would say, what do you do? You know, and I would share just very little. I'd say, oh, you know, I'm an FBI agent. And they're like, oh, I would always say, the FBI is what I do. It's not who I am. And then the day of my retirement, I remember giving the speech and I said, I used to always say the FBI is what I do. It's not who I am. It took me 20 years to realize I was wrong. It is who I am. I retired because my husband and I adopted a little girl, a baby at the time. I was eligible, so was my husband, and it was time, and we ended up moving to Southern California to chase the sun, and I miss it, but not to the point where I want to go back. So I've decided to find a different way to share my experiences with people. In January, I'm going to start teaching at the community college here, ethics, and they're letting me create a curriculum on human trafficking, which will be really cool because it's a way I can educate people and share my experience and knowledge. And that's what I really want to do. I feel like I have so much experience and knowledge and information in me that I need to share with people. After I retired, I became a public speaker because I wanted to tell people about this. I wanted to tell them what trafficking is and what's going on. And so now I can do it on the college level.
I like to give my guests the last word. So what would you like to say?
with regards to trafficking, if this is something you're about to start working or get into or investigate, be very, very careful and please take care of yourself. Self-care is very important. I know that as law enforcement, that's not something we're really good at because we think we're, you know, Wonder Woman and Superman and we can handle everything. But these cases are different. You're talking about little kids that people are hurting and you want to save them because that's our nature. And you have to be able to step away, recharge your batteries, because in fairness for them and the case as well, but otherwise it will eat you alive. I remember working these cases. I lost faith in mankind. Because you see evil. This is pure evil because these people, these traffickers, they're doing it for money. Oftentimes you see gangbangers who typically would not even speak to each other or look at each other or would shoot at the sight of each other, who will work together because of the money that they can make from trafficking. 95% of the people in this world, in this country, are good people. They're trying to pay their bills. They're trying to do right by their family. The little percentage that of evil that is out there that you are going to be seeing on a daily basis, and you start losing faith in mankind. So it's important to have a support system, to have good people around you, and to be able to step away when you can, which is hard because your phone is on all the time. The second thing I want to say is education is the best prevention, because there are people out there who don't have any idea what is going on. They don't know about trafficking, and it's their kiddo that sometimes gets caught up in it. So we have to educate people so we can prevent this from happening.
And that's the end of the interview. At jerrywilliams.com, you'll find a photo of Masayo Helpin, a link to a press release about the sentencing of Tony Armstrong, as well as a photo of him and images of evidence from the case. There are also articles about human trafficking and how the FBI investigates the violation. I hope you enjoyed the interview and that you'll share it with your friends, family, and associates. You can show me just how much you like the episode by buying me a coffee. There's a link in your podcast app's description of this episode, or you can go to my website and tap on the little coffee cup icon in the right-hand corner. Don't forget to follow FBI Retired Case File Review on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app. This podcast is all about true crime, but if you're also interested in crime fiction, once a month, via my monthly email, I keep you up to date on the FBI and books, TV, and movies. When you join my reader team, you get access to my FBI reading resource, a colorful list of more than 70 books about the FBI, books written by FBI agents who have been guests on this podcast, nonfiction, crime fiction, true crime, and memoirs. You'll also get my FBI reality checklist of 20 cliches about the FBI. I would love it if you also checked out the link for my books. My FBI for Armchair Detectives nonfiction series enables readers to discover who the FBI is and what the FBI does, debunking misconceptions about the FBI found in books, TV, and movies. And my Philadelphia FBI Corruption Squad procedural series features flawed female FBI agent Carrie Wheeler. My books are available as ebooks, paperbacks, and audiobooks wherever books are sold. And if you've already picked up copies, please consider leaving a review. Reviews help readers find good books. Thank you for listening to the very end. And I hope you come back for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.